my two-way interrogator. And then we said basically that essentially covariant derivative, there's a way to generalize the motion of directional derivative. Okay, we know that directional derivative is something that gives you the change. It measures the change in a scalar field in the direction of a given vector field or a vector. So what do we mean by generalization? That what we want to do is that we would like to define essentially kind of roughly in Rn, this becomes quite simplistic, as the change in the vector in the direction of a vector. Something that kind of measures the change in a scalar function in the direction of a vector field or a vector function. So now we want to generalize and take it to the vector set. How you can measure or how you can differentiate a vector in the direction of a vector. And then you can even more generalize it, and then you can say that, okay, how you can differentiate a tensor in the direction of another tensor. Another kind of generalization of it actually. Okay? But since we are only kind of sticking with the curves and surfaces, so we will need a very specific form of a covariant derivative. So we're interested in that. So how did we define? We said that, okay, if X is an arbitrary vector field, then I can treat del X. Something that we give it a name, Koszul connection. Okay. Connection is a map from a bundle of Rn into the bundle of Rn. Okay. And you define it abstractly. The definition that is presented is a bit abstract. If map that satisfies what we call following properties. So it behaves linearly, in the words that if I have del x of maybe some f y plus z, where f is some smooth scalar field and y and z are two vector field, then this must be same as f del x, okay, of y plus it's not only linear in on the vectors on which it is applied, but it's also linear with respect to the vectors and in which you are computing the array, in which you are interested in computing. So x is the vector, okay, in whose direction you want to compute the change actually in a given vector. So it's also linear with respect to this argument as well. Okay. Essentially, what does that mean? That it's a linear derivation actually. Okay. This means that it's a linear derivation. And what does the next property that it has is that if you have maybe fx plus z, or maybe y, and you operate it onto some z same as f del x, okay, of z plus del y. Okay.
Then my x and y pressure of free to the
please
can have a
yes. You have to. You this shows that it's a linear derivation actually. Okay? So it's linear and it's also derivation. So you have f del x, you are right. And then you have another term, x of f. Okay, so the directional derivative in the direction of y. In the direction of vector field x. Directional derivative of the scalar field in the direction of vector field x. And you're gonna get y plus the third term, which is del operator is a linear, but it's also a derivation. We defined it in the beginning of the course that if something is behaving like a differentiation operator, it must be a linear derivation. And it also satisfies this property. We did a quick example of it. We said, okay, if we are in Rn, okay, we are pretty happy, because if you take any vector field, for example, of this form, fi partial x by partial xi, where fi are some smooth, you know, scalar fields, and x is any other, what do you call x is any other vector field, then you can check actually that that the covariant derivative of this vector field y in the direction of x, okay, is basically this expression, that is x of f ru. For a given vector field, if you define this derivative in this manner, x of f partial x by partial xi, then this satisfies these both properties actually. Then this del x, sorry? Then del x is a connection. Okay? So it's like connection is something that gives you the covariant derivative. Okay? But for a map to be connection, it must satisfy this.
Obviously,
This one is more elementary. The rest of the things can be expressed, you know, if we have this. So let's try to make sense of these quantities. Some of the things we already did actually. But I would like to repeat them quickly once again. So we saw in last discussion that if I take the connection, Koszul connection, in other words, if I compute the covariant derivative of the frame vector EI, or maybe if I set up a notation that, okay, like E1, E2, EN, okay, is orthogonal basis, or frame basically, not necessarily orthonormal, okay. Maybe we can assume it orthonormal, okay. But we'll see that. But if we need, we will assume it, otherwise, just take it as general. Okay, so it's a frame, diaphragm, it's kind of an orthonormal basis of energy space, okay, R and Rn. And then by theta 1, theta 2, and I mean coframe, huh? These are basically one forms. Okay. And then we also assume that these one forms are dual to the EIs actually, because if you take theta I and operate it on EJ, you're going to get delta I. So this would be what you call the underlying assumption, okay, for the rest of the calculation. Now, if I compute the covariant derivative of some vector EI in the direction of the vector X actually, okay, then we said previously, as I discussed it in the last class, that then this is a vector, okay, and a vector can be expressed in the terms of the basis again. So in other words, I can express them in the basis EJ. Okay? This is a vector in Rn because definition is telling me that, okay, it takes a tangent vector and throws it in tangent vector. So that's a vector. So if this is a vector, then you must be also able to write it in the terms of, again, the frame again. Okay? Obviously, you require some scalars here. Okay? And those scalars, we call those scalars as a connection forms. So those would be functions actually, okay. And we denoted them by wji, okay, operated on the x actually. So these would be what you call essentially the scalar fields. And we gave them name that these are called the connection forms actually. Connection forms, okay, of this operator del x actually are associated with the operator del x. Okay, are the connection form associated with the frame. Okay, so it's like in this notation, these wji are called what you call the connection form. And you can see that if you have these known to you, okay, then you can have a you have a complete description, okay, that how to compute the covariant derivative of a arbitrary vector field in the direction of x. You can just express it using these connection forms. Okay? So how many of these are going to be? So how many of these are going to be? So it's going to be so for each one here, okay, for example, so if you are in R3, say, for each one here, you're going to get three vectors here. So you'll have three such quantities. So in total, you're going to have nine quantities. So if you are in N, you're going to have N square actually.
Okay?
These are unique. They are going to be unique. Why? Because if you express a vector, like if you apply a transformation over the basis vector, you get some constants which are unique actually. So you get matrix which is unique associated with it. So essentially this is nothing, this is just a, you know, from linear Lebesgue point of view, this is a matrix representation of this operator. It's a matrix representation of the operator. We know that every operator can be written as a matrix, can be seen as a matrix. So I can say that, okay, if I take this W, then W, okay, and WJI of X, then this is just a, you know, n by n matrix. Okay. And these quantities are called the connection points. There's a lot more, we discussed it, you know, we can browse through it, but I would like to get to the, you know, new things. I'm not repeating every single thing that we did last time. Okay, so obviously the next thing you will be interested in. What would be, okay, the covariant derivative of Ej in the direction of Ei actually? So going more elemental. Okay? What would be the covariant derivative of Ej in the direction of Ei? By the way, there is another way to interpret this matrix actually, connection form. So somehow, the connection measures that connection measures the rotation, okay, roughly, when a point is moving in the direction of the vector x actually. So you can also treat that as a rotation matrix as well. So you can have, when we're going to do examples, you will see that it's indeed, you know, it represents some kind of abstract rotation actually. Or if you see it from in a particular context, it represents. So all these have a limitation actually. Anyway, so this is what that I would like to describe. Okay? This would be an even better quantity because even, you know, such kind of quantities can be expressed in this manner. So again, this would be a vector, okay, which you can express, you know, in the terms of the basis vector. Okay? So what would be the basis vector? Let's call that k. Okay? And the coefficient, whatever the coefficient is, okay, let's denote that coefficient by symbol gamma. Okay? And what must be the indices on gamma? So one must be
k, k, j.
Okay, k, not only j, but I, j as well. K and ij as well, because you know you are operating. Okay, so this k is for the sum actually. But why you have these ij? Because you are, like, this is to remind you that you are computing the covariant derivative of ej vector in the direction of ei. Is it making sense? So I'm using this symbol. Okay, and these symbols are called. Call the Koszul symbols. We'll talk about them in the next chapter. These are very, very important quantities. If you know metric, you know Koszul symbol, you know everything about, you know most of the things about. You know, this is called Koszul. Koszul symbols. Quantities are going to be unique. Obviously, these are also going to be, you know, connection forms. Okay, but we shouldn't confuse these connection forms with connection forms. These connection forms. Okay, there's a big difference. Is there a obviously a question. Is there a relationship between these connection forms and this connection form? Obviously ask the question actually. In order to know that, okay, what you can do is this. have coframe on both sides to this equation. So you're going to get, so if I have maybe theta k, okay, and the theta j operated on the, this theta j operated on del x, okay, er. So you need to operate theta j contour wij and ej, right? And this would be, this would give us what?
Matrix
size. So this is, so these are like scalars, right? This is a linear map actually. Okay, these are one forms. They are bases of the dual spaces. So they are linear maps. So these are kind of scalars actually. So you can pull them out. You will have it wij, obviously operated on the x, and theta j of ej. So this is going to be 1 actually. So I can express explicitly, you know, connection forms also as the dual, you know, the dual vectors operated on the connection forms actually. Is it making sense? Now why this is interesting? This is interesting because if I, okay, if I do what? If I take on the place of x, if I take what? So if I take wij, or maybe if I take, okay, now. So what I want to do, I want to have an explicit relationship between these connection forms, the Christoffel symbol and these omega ij. So in other words, if you know one, you can compute others. Okay? So, okay, since I and j would be already involved here, so if I replace in this identity x by, okay, so it's like if I replace ei by, okay, ej and x by ei, so you're going to have accordingly, you know, changes here. But, okay, I can do what? I can keep everything same. So I can say that, that let's take theta j and let's operate it on ek, for example, ei. Okay, let's keep everything as it is. And equal to, so you're going to have wij operated on the ek. But what would be the theta j operated on to this quantity? But I know that this quantity, I can write it in the terms of a Christoffel symbol. So this would be theta j operated on. So what would be the Christoffel symbol form for this actually? So I can say that this is same as what? So it's going to be gamma, okay? Gamma, ki or ik? Ki. So I have k and I here, okay, and I need some index.
Make it P or Q.
Maybe I can put some P here, okay. Or should I put a J here?
No, J
is already here.
I know.
So let's put a P here, okay. So you're gonna get a wash. So must lie here, and then you'll have. Let's call it EP. Okay. So if this would be the case, then theta j operated on the EP will give you P K I equal to W I J E K. Okay. And theta j operated on the EP would give you delta jp.
Yes.
Okay, so it's going to give you delta jp. Okay. And so ultimately, what you're going to get is this delta j ki, okay, equal to
wij
j. E, K, okay, we're going to get that.
Sir, Christoffel symbol, P, K, I.
Huh? No, but the, but this delta would multiply with p will get rid of this. The index function. In order to put it. So keeping it to this expression, try to guess. So I just want to write it, you know, in more natural manner. In other words, rather than writing j k I, I want to write this the same expression as I j k actually. Gamma I j k. So what would be gamma I j k? So if I just change the index and I write, for example, okay, maybe gamma k I j, so what would be the impact on the other side? So it's gonna be w k I of e j. It's same thing. Okay. W k I of e j.
So I k omega I k.
Anyway, you can verify. Okay, look at it. You can think about it. It should be something similar. So that's what I wanted to, you know, fix the indices from the first place. But okay. Or you can read to this actually. Alright? And what? Just an alternate way. So in other words, I can I can also interpret what you call Christoffel symbols as something that when